Good morning all. So in this lecture number 7, we'll discuss about cell disruption techniques. In the lecture number 6, we have seen several types of bacteria based on the nutrient source they consume. We have seen the autotrophic and heterotrophic bacteria, and we have seen some of the complex biomolecules such as carbohydrates, lipids. We have seen cell nutrition and growth mediums. So in this lecture, we will discuss about cell lysis, which is cell disruption techniques. Okay. Why we have to do this cell disruption technique is, first we have seen that we have seen the components that are present in the cell, right? So we have seen it consists of whether it is prokaryotes or eukaryotes. We have seen they have some plasma membranes, they have nucleus or nucleoids, they have cytoplasm. Right, they have ER and endoplasmic reticulum, and we have seen several organelles that are present in it, right? So how to separate them out? Say for example, one of them is useful to us. How it is separated out, the cell has to be done it. Okay, for particular, we have seen this, we are going to discuss in detail in this module 2 and 3. We are going to discuss about enzyme kinetics and fermentation technology, reactor design, all that, right? So I told you that the process that are involved in this industrial biotechnology or biochemical engineering can be classified into two. One is upstream processing, then harvesting, then we have downstream processing. So even if this product, even if you consider it as to be the downstream processing, the process that is like microorganism will consume the nutrients or substrate that we are supplying to it, and it may provide us the product, it may excrete the product outside the cell wall. So we have that microorganism, outermost shell is cell wall, so it will consume the substrate, it will convert them into, it's like it acts like a catalyst, means it will form some of the products which are useful to us. There are two type of product. Sometimes the product, it will excrete out of the cell wall, or sometimes it will contain the product within it. So that way, if we come to this downstream processing, if it is three type of products can be formed in this biochemical reactions, either we may need the cell itself. Okay, the cell formed may be the desired product for us. In that case, we have to separate that cell and take out, isolate it and purify it. Or other way, there are two other products. One is intracellular product, or it can be extracellular. Extracellular means the product that is formed from the substrate within the cell will be excreted outside the cell wall. Okay, so that needs to be separated out. Or other way, what happens, it will form the product, but it will be contained within the cell. So it will be present within the cell wall. So, but that is our desired product. So we have to separate it out and make use of it, right? So all this, again, if it is to study the cell and separate out the components, the cell disruption techniques are used. Otherwise, in the bioseparation techniques, or in the final module, you might have seen these downstream processing. Whatever product that is formed through the fermentation reactions, so they are contained within the cells. So again, to isolate or separate out the products, we need these cell disruption techniques. Okay, so in general, any microorganism is protected by its cell wall. We know that the cell wall will be thick in nature. So depending upon the organism and depending upon the environment it grows, so based on its nature, that cell wall thickness will vary, right? Some cell wall may be very thin and weak, some cell walls may be thick, right? So, but if the product has to be released outside the cell wall, so we have to make use of the cell disruption techniques. Even in case of yeast cells, they are very difficult to disrupt. In that case, because it won't allow the solvent to pass through the cell wall. Okay, so we remember all this acts like some membrane ions, so it is not allowing the solvent to pass through it, right? So that type of cells are also there. And in general, any type of cells like bacteria, molds, or plant cells, or mammalian cells, or ground tissues, they all need some or other cell disruption techniques. Okay, cell disruption technique is we want to loosen the cell wall without damaging the parts present in it. Like, we don't want to damage the organelles present in it, or nucleus present in it, or cytoplasm present in it, or gobi complex present in it. We only want to separate, break the compound, or you can say they would only break the cell wall. Okay, so then whatever is the organelles present as it is, or the liquid present in it, we want to separate them out using some other techniques like centrifuges. Okay, so there are several techniques available to do the cell cell disruption. So it can be a physico-mechanical technique or chemical technique, or sometimes some enzymes itself acts like to loosen the cell wall of the other microorganisms. Okay, so these are the different methods available which we will discuss in detail. So among the various methods available, which method to choose depends upon the characteristics. Okay, so the so for example, a particular cell is there, if you, it's like sending a play fight between two people, right? So if you two teams are there, the opponent is weak, we don't need a strongest person in our team to go and fight with that person, right? So like that, while choosing the method for cell breaking also, we can make use, it depends upon the susceptibility of the cells to get broken. So that needs to be considered. Okay, it can be easily broken, mean we don't need any costly method, or we don't need a big hammer to hit it and break it, right? So that way the susceptibility of the cells to get broken, and also the product stability characteristic, the content, that means inside the cell wall, what are the organelles or the product that is formed. So what is the stability, its characteristics also we have to consider. Also, once how easily we can extract the products, desired products from the cell debris. Cell debris means once we break the cell, we get two products. One is liquids and another is solid cell debris, right? So how easily we can extract the desired product out of it also, we'll consider whether we can go for a liquid extraction method or we should we go for a solid method kind of thing. Okay, and also how quickly a method can do the separation for us, or how quickly we can separate out the desired product from the cell. Okay, once we are only talking about the organelles present in the cell and the fluid that is present in the cell. Okay, and also we have obviously what is the cost of the operation involved also needs to be considered when we are choosing a method for cell disruption. Okay, so if I look at the classify them based on the principle involved, remember in general any purification method will try to make use of the physical properties and chemical properties, right? So based on its density difference or how it changes its state when we alter the temperature and pressure, when you cool it, what it happens, solidifies or not, like so like that. Even density decanters are there, centrifugal forces can be made use, right? So based on the physical and chemical properties, we are trying to that is the principle which will be used to separate out the various components present in the cell. So if you classify them as mechanical method, purely mechanical method, we have liquid shear method and solid shear method, and we have physical methods like our osmotic shocks, thermolysis and decompression. And under chemical methods, we try to introduce them, introduce the cell into some of the chemical environment like detergent solutions, alkaline alkylating agents, or sometimes antibiotics also can be used. And we have enzyme treatment. As I said, some of the enzymes can do the role of loosening the cell wall of the microorganisms. So that way enzymatic treatment also can be utilized. Okay, and so how to define what is cell disruption technique or cell lysis? Cell lysis is the process of breaking the cell wall and or the membrane to release the intracellular fluids containing the molecules or particles of interest. So this is the case when we have the product form. If you take simple cell, we are only concerned about the content present in it, like whatever it is there, nucleus or nucleide or endoplasmic reticulum or organelles, all that. Okay, so if it is involved in a fermentation product, then and the product formed is like intracellular type, then we are concerned about the fluid product, whatever product is containing. That in that case, it is intracellular fluids containing molecules or particles of interest. Okay, so this definition is with respect to downstream processing step, like bioseparation techniques. Okay. Remember, otherwise it is going to be intracellular material such as DNA, RNA, protein or organelles from the cell. So what is the overall goal in this? In the overall goal in the cell description is to obtain the what is the intracellular fluid present in it, but we should not damage the component, any of the components in it. So without much damage to it, we damage to the organelles present in it, we want to take out the components present in it, inside the cell wall of any microorganism. Okay. So this the method that we are using may be depending upon the, obviously it will based on, we have seen the choice of method, right? It will be based on the type of the cell and the composition of the cell wall, how thick it is, whether how hard it is to get easily relax the cell wall and let the fluid in flow out of it. Okay, so that we will do. If you look at these, this also called a cell fractionation. So in general, means without any product involved is not there. One simplest method to be used is, so in general we will be using a cell fraction, centrifugation technique will be used. Okay, so centrifugal techniques. So centrifugal technique is used. In this way, as I said, the physical properties or chemical properties of the components are based on the properties, the components are isolated. So what we do is three steps are involved in it. First step is we dissolve, it's like how we wash our clothes, right? We first put it into a soap solution. First we put the dirty cloths into the bucket full of water with the detergent and we dip it for some time and without washing machine, I am telling. So we put it in that, even in washing machine it is done automatically. So first step is we suspend the cell in a solution to let it let the dirt to loosen and come out of it, right? So that means some mechanism is involved in it, similar to it. Here we are dissolving to let the cell wall to get loosen up. So that's called a tissue homogenate. That can be done using some ultrasonication step or rotating vessel within a tube. And then what happens? The cells are broken apart using some technique. And then what we will do is when you do centrifuge, we get a, so solids will be made into pellet form or precipitate at the bottom. And we have a solution at the top, which is called a supernatant. And then we have solid. So sometimes depending upon the aim of the work, aim of the cell disruption, sometimes our desired product may be the solid part, that is the precipitate that we obtain at the bottom. Or otherwise, if our desired product is a liquid, it will be present in the supernatant or the liquid at the top. So in whichever phase our desired product is there, that we will isolate again, and on successive fractionation, similar method we will do, successively we will isolate the desired components present in it. Okay. So if you look at how the centrifugation is done.
The amount of lysis can be analyzed by centrifuging the samples. Sample on the left is before lysis. Sample on the right is after lysis.
It's a typical tabletop centrifuge we use.
Lysis can be analyzed after centrifugation by looking at the amount of bacteria still remaining in the two samples. Sample on the left is before French pressing. Sample on the right is after French pressing. Note that there are still many bacteria present in the sample on the left, but none in the sample on the right.
So this way the centrifugation is done to separate out the solid parts and the liquid parts. So sometimes the desired product may be present in the solid, otherwise it will be present in the liquid. Okay, so if it is a process of downstream processing. Okay. So when you centrifuge, we know the principles, right? So if you look at the, so in general what we do is when a centrifuge is, we have studied in fluid mechanics also, right? That one of the, we apply one central portion will be rotating with omega. Okay, we have outer shell. So what happens is this will act, rotate at, if it is a central portion, if it is the central axis. So when the centrifuge is spun at a high speed, what happens? The particle suspended in the liquid, it will move away from the central axis. So it will go and it will get hit at the surface. So that way, so there will be movement of this particle suspended in the liquid, moving away from the central axis and hitting the wall. So thereby, so we cause the disruption to the cell. And this rate of movement of this particle will depend upon three things. What is that? It depends upon the size, shape, and density of the particles, right? So based on that, it will be moving at the movement. The rate of movement will depend upon the particle sizes, shape, and the density. Okay, so this is what we do in the first step. So in general, what is being done is tissue homogeneity is done. What is the tissue homogeneity? It is dissolved in something like ultrasonication, I told. So it is tissue homogenization is done. So then what we do is we centrifuge for 10 minutes with 600 g. So usually we say the rotation of the shaft speed in rpm, right? How this rpm is related to the gravity force? What is the rpm versus this g? So we know the rpm is revolutions per minute, right? We say that 500 rpm, 600 rpm, like that. So what is this unit of 600 g? I'll explain that later. So first thing to do is what we get is nuclei and cells are obtained. So this is what we do during the disruption of the cell, not about the downstream processing step. If it is not downstream processing step, our concern is to separate out the parts of the cells, right? So right now, so what we do is when we do this, what we get is nuclei and cells are obtained. So again, we will centrifuge the supernatant . This also will be done for 5 minutes but with the 15,000 g. Again, the unit is different. Okay, so what we get is the remaining part, we get the mitochondria and lysosomes. So refer to previous lecture for all the components of the cells. So further, what we can do is again, this is the successive steps. Okay, so again, we do the centrifuge for 1 hour. With 1 lakh g speed, what we get is endoplasmic reticulum and ribosomes. So this is the way the cells are separated out. Okay, so this endoplasmic reticulum and ribosomes are obtained, and from that again, if you take out the supernatant, it will have the soluble portion of cytoplasm. So these are the components of cells we have seen, right? So cytoplasm, ribosomes, endoplasmic reticulum, mitochondria, lysosomes, nuclei, nucleus or nuclei, all that. Okay, so now what is this G as a engineers? So we know that this G is the force or relative gravitational or centrifugal force. So how it is converted is this G is equal to 1.118 into 10 power minus 5 R into S square, where R is the radius of the rotor in centimeters, whereas S is the speed in RPM. Okay, so why I am introducing is in biotechnology we don't represent the centrifugal for speed as in RPM. So we have to make use of this UG. So what is, so G, how to convert is if you know the RPM. Remember, when you say RPM, it doesn't take care of the what is the radius of the shaft, right? Some rotating part is there, right? What is its diameter, we don't know, right? So diameter, what is the diameter of this rotating shaft, is not taken care when you express it in RPM. Okay, whereas in case of this, express this in terms of relative centrifugal force, RCF or RGF. So how using this relationship we can convert it. Okay, so when you have this one, so for example, if you know some shaft is having a diameter of 14 centimeters, diameter is 14 centimeters means radius is 7 centimeters, and if you know the RPM is like 5000 RPM, then what is the value of G? Will you substitute and tell me, one of you? Anybody listening? G is equal to 1.118 into 10 power minus 5. Converting means if a shaft is, means if a rotor is having a 7 centimeter radius and RPM of 5000, what is its the value, equivalent value in G units? So G unit is acceleration due to gravity, that G, whatever is the unit, same unit it will also have. Okay. So what is the value? 1.118 into 10 power minus 5 into R is 7. In centimeter we have to substitute because it is an empirical equation. 7 into S is, speed is 5000 RPM. So 5000 square. Yeah, one of you tell me the value. We'll get around 1500 to 2000. Is it close to 2000 or 1500?
Sir, 1956, sir.
Okay, very good. 1956.5.
0.5, yes.
Yeah.
Sir.
So we can say that this is the factor in terms of gravity. What is the G value? So it is like this force is equivalent to G value we know, right? So depending upon the location, it is going to change. We have 9.81 meter per second square. So it is like this much times G. 1956.5 times G. So this is the equivalent of the rotation. Because we are taking into account of what is the diameter and what is the local gravity. Okay, so this is how it is expressed. So this is called times gravity. How much times gravity value, like that it is expressed. Okay, when I say times gravity, that is how we are expressing now. Now we have seen in the previous slide, we have seen 600 times gravity, 1500 times gravity, 1 lakh times gravity, right? So when you say that way, so we are trying to represent, you can back calculate to know what is the corresponding RPM we are fixing in the centrifuge. Okay, for example, this is one of the conversion table which is made, because obviously that empirical equation is G equal to 1.118 into 10 power minus 5 R into S square. So if the radius is in centimeters starting from 4 to 15, and if the RPM is varying from 1000 to 14000, so we can make a table, right? So what we have calculated now, we have taken a 5000 RPM and 7 centimeter radius. So our value was close to, this is rounded off, okay? So we got exactly like 1956 point something, right? So that way this value, this is, what does it mean? 1957 times G, if I represent, this is the, say we have seen, this is the value. What does it mean? So we are mentioning that shaft diameter, this rotor diameter, diameter is 14 centimeters and the RPM value is 5000. Okay, so that way, this is also the way to express the centrifuge force how we are applying. Okay, this is called a times gravity unit. Okay, but however, for a bench top micro centrifuge, like whatever we are doing in our laboratory, what is, it's like using our mixie at home. So you know how much time we have to run our mixie to get the contents of a chutney to get ready. So it's like tabletop model. So as long as we get our desired product and desired taste and desired texture, so we don't mind how much time, and because it is a batch process. In batch process, it is not a concern how much time or how much speed we are doing, right? Say if your mother asks you to do the chutney for this thing, she has done everything, added all contents into the jar, and she is asking you to run the mixie for some time. So what we'll do, we'll do randomly sometime, right? 10 minutes or 15 minutes, 20 minutes. So it's like optimum time is required, right? If you are keeping at 1, how much time? Keeping at 2, how much time? So we will come to know if you are regularly doing it, right? Otherwise, you have to open the jar cap and you have to see whether it is done or not, otherwise you will run it for some more time. Similar to that, the centrifuge also, if you are using a bench top centrifuge for a part batch operations, so the speed and time are sufficient to ensure the cell and debris are pelleted effectively. What is our aim? The cell in the cell containing the cell wall should be disturbed completely so that the constituents present in it should be easily separated out. So that's what we have to do in this centrifuge also. So if we have sufficient time and sufficient speed is given to disturb the cell wall so that we can take out the intracellular fluid and the constituents in it, that will be sufficient. Okay, so but for industrial operation, we have to do energy balance, material balance, all that, right? So that way, it is important that we take care of optimum time and the speed is being utilized. So whereas for batch operation, it's not a big concern. Okay, so one of the widely, for lab scale operations, one of the widely used cell disruption technique is ultrasonication. So ultrasonication is one of the widely used method for this lab scale one. Whereas in industrial scale, the cost is needs to be optimized. Okay, it is not being widely used so far, but still people are working on in hydrodynamic cavity. All that this coming under chemical engineering role one day to optimize the method, how to effectively get the cell disrupted, all that. Okay. So what is ultrasonication? So even if this is used for various things, ultrasonication is used to dissolve some of the solvents. If you are doing your BTEC project experimentally, you might have coming across this ultrasonication instead of mechanical agitator. In earlier days, what we do, we keep A, B, C, we want to mix together or dissolve some A into B. What we'll do, we'll mix A, put A into B, then we'll put some agitator, it will be rotating, agitator blades will be there, agitated vessels are used to dissolve the things, right? So instead of agitation using this mechanical, later what we did, we started using magnetic stirrers, right? In a small test tube, I hope you might have done some experiment in laboratory. So you take a small test tube, put a solution and magnetic stirrer will be there, like a Teflon coated small magnetic will be there. You keep it on a magnetic stirrer and start it. That magnetic rod, small rod will be rotating. So thereby also we are doing. So that is the alternative to mechanical agitation. These are all mechanical agitation or magnetic stirring is done, right? So instead of these two, another method is this ultrasonication method, where sound waves are injected or even some cavities are formed. So high pressure is there, that cavities are bursting, which will effectively allow the solute to get dissolved in the liquid, or even two liquids needs to be mixed, or you want some catalyst is there, you want to make a catalyst dissolved in something, so that you want to mix some A and B. For example, in fuel cells, all this, we have to dissolve platinum in carbon. So what we'll do, we'll take platinum 10%, 90% carbon. So carbon can be produced using different techniques. I hope in renewable energy sources or other electric sources you might have come across. We can take any biomass and do some burning kind of thing, pyrolysis, all that. You can heat treat it in a tubular furnace to get a carbon, activated carbon. So that will be act serves the role of carbon support. So you have a costly catalyst platinum. So you'll take 10-8%. So for example, I want to make 500 grams of catalyst, so 10% means 50 grams of platinum, the remaining 450 grams of carbon, we will mix it and we want to dissolve it. So otherwise we will be using mechanical stirrer. Here we can use, if you keep it in this ultrasonic bath, so we get nice dissolution. Okay, same way here in this cell dissolution also. So for example, if you look at this one of the several applications are there. If you look at the application in extraction of oil in the, from this bath, so there will, you will have some transducer, I will have, call it as horn, at a particular amplitude we will switching it on. So what will happen is, once you switch on this sound waves, so this will allow this. Okay, here oil is extracted from some okay. So this way, even for cell disruption, this ultrasonication can be utilized. So we will have two phases, you can see. One will be, you can separate them out using filtration or other ways of natural methods. Okay. So once this came, we have this, okay, that's not our concern right now. So that way, the ultrasonication process, we make use of some pulsed or high frequency sound waves to agitate the lyse cells, bacteria, spores, or finely diced tissues. So what we are trying to do is, in this process in which sound waves are used to agitate the particles in the solution. So that such disruption can be used to mix solutions, speed the dissolution of a solid into the liquid, and remove the dissolved gases from the liquid. Okay, so in even in this recombinant protein production procedures, this cell disruption is used, where ultrasonic cell disruption is used in the laboratory scale method, because it has been used for a long time, because it is the easiest method in with respect to lab scale. But for with respect to industrial scale, the cost involved is more, so that way the people go for alternative methods. Okay, so another method is called as osmotic shock method. So this is again a physical method. So osmotic shock in the sense is, we know that if you introduce suddenly you change the salt concentration in the cell or the cell containing liquid, when the environment we are changing the concentration of the salt, so that way we are introducing some shock to it. Okay, so that also helps in releasing the hydrolytic enzymes or binding proteins from the bacteria. Okay, that is one way of cell disruption technique, osmotic shock.
Such as osmotic shock. The transfer of cells to a hypertonic environment, which has a lower osmotic pressure than the cytoplasm of the cells, causes the cells to absorb water and burst.
Okay, so this all will come under, there are two types as I said, one is a liquid shear type and a solid shear type. If you look at the liquid shear, it is a widely used method, particularly for large scale enzyme production processes, liquid shear is used. So liquid shear is coming under the high, for example, high pressure homogenizers are used, for example, in the processing of milk or other products in the food industries. It is the liquid shearing or high pressure homogenizer is the widely used technique in the large scale for microbial cell disruption, because a microbial cell's size and shape will influence the ease of disruption, and this degree of disruption and the amount of protein released will be used to subsequent separation of the products. Okay, so obviously we have to make a trade-off between percentage release of the product required, how difficult is the process involved, and what is the cost of the purification step involved. Okay, so that's why we have this high pressure homogenization technique. So we have seen the what is the principle Bernoulli's equation application in orifice meter, right? So we suddenly change the pressure, and thereby we try to introduce the eddies into the downstream side of the orifice plate, and we try to measure the pressure difference across the pipeline, right? So that way one is a flow measuring device we use, right? Similar, that similar technique is used here in the high pressure homogenization. Okay, so this high pressure homogenization technique, what we do is we will be allowing the we will be forcing the cell suspension. So first the cell will dissolve, like tissue homogeneity is done, right? We dissolve it in some solvent and keep it for some time so that the cell wall is ready to get released if applying second step some pressure is applied. Okay, so that in that way the cell suspension is forced at high pressure through a very small narrow orifice, and it will come out to the atmospheric pressure. So the sudden release of high pressure also creates some liquid shear, so that will help the cell to get broken. Okay, so if you look at this video, this is how a typical high pressure homogenization will look like.
Moving the standard pressure cell. Put the piston's T handle onto the J hooks beneath the top platen. The top of the piston inserts into a recess hole in the top platen. Be careful not to bang your fingers or other items. Rotate so that the sample outlet tube faces the front in the direction of the collecting beaker. A run of flexible tubing can be added to direct the flow. The flow valve assembly should be to the left side and is clear to turn. Swing the safety clamp onto the top shoulder of the cell body. Be sure the metal brackets are not touching the piston or it can scratch it. Be sure the small screw on the cell body is not underneath the safety clamp but in the back. Secure down by tightening the two thumb screws. Position the sample outlet tube and extension flexible tube to direct the output into the collection beaker that is sitting in the tray. As the lower platen moves, this tray will ride up to stay in position while collecting the sample.
Yeah, I hope like it is similar to the fluid mechanics orifice meter experiment. You have small orifice through which we allow the liquid to pass through to measure the flow rate. Okay. And here this is liquid shear. If the same can be done for solid shear applications also. For solid shear applications, suitability, the solid shear methods are suitable for lab scale applications. Okay, so for example, it can be done in the semi-continuous mode for thing. So what happens is we apply this we first freeze the small microorganisms, and then we allow it to pass through similar thing, like through a small orifice. What happens again there also, this frozen condition it is there, that's why that will also help the microorganisms to get broken, that cell wall to get broken, so that we can recover the intracellular fluids. Okay, because if it is in solid shear, we talk about the ices present, ice is formed, ice cubes are formed, or the liquids present in the cells are get frozen, right? So that way these ice crystals also will have some rough structure, right? So when this cell wall is hitting that ice cube or ice crystals, so again that it will help the cell disruption. Okay, so that is another technique. Or there is another method called as agitation with abrasives, like mechanical disruption. We have seen mechanical abrasion course, or you might have seen the ball mill, how we use ball mill to size reduce the components, right? So for example, n number of balls will be present in the ball mill. It's like a cylindrical shell in which small beads are taken. So similar to ball mill, if it is in small scale, we call it as beads. Okay, so that way some agitation with abrasives is one of the technique where mechanical disruption is affected using some beads. Okay, so these beads, we know that can be made up of glass or polymers or titanium or alumina compounds. Okay, so what happens, the shear force caused inside the hollow cylinder by a system of agitator vessels will process the cell disruption. Remember, when you are doing so, it will be like exothermic because heat is generated. So we should have an efficient cooling system in the system, so that thermal degradation or thermal denaturation of the desired products are not happening in the system. Remember, this agitation with abrasive method can be extended for even large scale applications, industrial scale applications also. So as I told, this mechanical disruption using beads can be affected using some glass, alumina or titanium compounds. So this is a typical bead mill. So these grinding jars will have a screw top design so that no leakage, so 100% recovery of the product is there, and you won't have any sample losses. And there is an automatic adjustment of position so that you will get the reproducible results. So once you switch on this one, there will be oscillation movement, and the material will be moving from left to right in the radial direction, and the balls also will cause impact on it. So this, you get this mechanical disruption is done using the beads. Okay, particularly if you look at the cell disruption, we want to do it in using some vials, right? So such vials will be used. You can keep the sample in this box, and you can have at least 10 samples at a time, and you can fix this. And the cells at high velocity and pressure are forced to hit either a stationary surface or a second stream of suspended cells, so that way also the cells are disrupted by the forces. Okay, so for
attrition, microfluidizer processors are ideal for rupturing a variety of cells which all require different shear rates, like mammalian cells, bacteria, algae, yeast. They need different cells. Okay, users can optimize the cell lysis rates while minimizing the temperature increases and avoiding the denaturing of the intracellular materials. Here if you see a sample of cells which have yet to be disrupted, the microfluidizer works by first placing the sample into the inlet reservoir like this. So the sample feeds to the intensifier pump, which is capable of forcing the cells into the interaction chamber at incredibly high pressures. So inside this interaction chamber, the sample is separated into micro channels. These micro channels are engineered such that they are as thin as the human hair. So the stream of cells then accelerate and collide with the chamber and each other, which results in the extreme forces, impact and shear. So the micro channels can be multiplied and aligned in parallel, which ensures consistent, accurate results during the scale up. So the finished product is then effectively cooled in the outlet cooling coil or heat exchanger, and the product is collected. So if you compare the process sample to its original state, we can appreciate the effectiveness of the microfluidization.
So among the methods that we have discussed, the ultrasonication method, this high pressure homogenization, impingement method, and grinding with galvanized glass beads methods are mechanical in nature, whereas this osmotic shock and heat shock. Heat shock refers to the thermo heating. It's like by suddenly heating the cell containing solution to a certain temperature, we can affect the thing. It's like thermal shock we are giving. So that is also non-mechanical method. Okay, so among the non-mechanical methods, osmotic shocks, heat shocks, and other methods are chemical and enzymatic methods. So chemical method we will discuss. So what is a chemical method? So chemical methods are like we treat the cells with some alkalis or organic solvents or detergents, which can easily facilitate the lysing of the cell to release the organelles or fluids kind of present in the cells. Okay, so if you look at the alkalis, this is alkali treatment has been used for the extraction of some of the bacterial proteins. However, the alkali stability of the desired product is very crucial for the success of this method. Okay, if you look at the example, some recombinant growth hormone can be effectively released from this E. coli by treatment with sodium hydroxide at a pH of 11. So that is one of the example for alkali method, alkali cell disruption method. And if you look at the organic solvents, so several water miscible organic solvent can be used to disrupt the cells, like methanol. We can use methanol, ethanol, isopropanol, butanol, etc. But one problem is these compounds are inflammable, so we have to ensure specialized. Because when you are looking at a large scale, in lab scale no issue, we are going to make use of test tube kind of thing. But if you are doing some it in big vessels, agitated vessels, large vessels, you have to ensure the take care of safety precautions. Okay, among the solvents, toluene is one of the frequently used solvent, because toluene is known to dissolve the membrane phospholipids and it creates a membrane pores for the release of the contents of the cell. Okay, and another thing chemical that can be used is detergents. So detergents that are ionic in nature and cationic, this kind of sodium lauryl sulfate is a well-known detergent. Okay, this can be used to denature the membrane proteins and for the cell lysation. Okay, so
soap dissolves the cell membranes because they are basically layers of oil that is surrounding the cell, right? So in other words, dish soap destroys cell membranes in the same way that it cleans oil of the dishes and pans. So cell membranes and oil are both made up of molecules called lipids. So at concentrations below this critical one, so these detergent monomers bind to water-soluble proteins. Detergent monomers solubilize the membrane proteins by partitioning into the membrane bilayer. With increasing amounts of detergents, membranes undergo various stages of solubilization. So the initial stage is lysis or rupture of the membrane.
There are some non-ionic detergents also there, but although they are less reactive than the ionic ones. Some Triton, X100, Etrin are some of the well-known detergents, which are non-ionic detergents, which are used to do cell lysing. Okay. The problem with this using this detergent is they will affect the purification step, because remember you have to remove this detergent. So that means in the purification or the salt precipitation, all this needs to be modified when you are using detergents. Okay. But however, if you use, additionally, if you use some ultrafiltration or ion exchange chromatography for purification, then these detergents can be used. And another method is there, which is called freeze-thaw lysis method.
Another useful method is freeze-thawing method. Actually, how the rocks crack and may become stones is this process. It also follows the same process of freeze-thawing. Actually, when it is raining, the water will be collected on the top of the rock, and wherever crack is there, the water will be filled. So when during the temperature change, water will freeze. When it is freezing, it will expand, so forcing the crack to widen. So ice-thaws will contract, again water gets deeper into crack. So in this way, freezing and defrozen. So that way this water, rocks will get split. Okay, so that's what happening in the nature. That thing can be exploited in this cell disruption technique also. So it's a very mild process. So repeated freezing and thawing of the cell, and the ice crystals will generate pores in the cell wall. It will weaken the cell wall and open. So it will facilitate the release of the enzymes.
So among this, what will happen is sometimes if you use some solution called as hypotonic solutions, or there isotonic solutions or hypotonic solutions, during these processes are gentle in nature. What happens is the cells will swell and burst when they are suspended in this hypotonic solution, so which will release the cellular contents. As the name indicates, what we do is we frozen and suddenly bring it to the room temperatures. Again frozen and again bring it to the room temperature or above 0 degree. So that is called thawing, like defrosting, freezing and defreezing. Okay, so that is what being done in freeze-thaw lysis process. So in that, what happens is that even the ice that is present in it will help for the cell disruption. So we have seen that either the cell disruption technique can be physical, chemical or biological in nature. So with respect to reagent based methods, the characteristics of the reagent based methods for lysing the cell, like alkalines, alcohols or solvents. Okay, so that method will be rapid, gentle, efficient and reproducible method. And it will lead to some high yield of the protein or the desired products. And it can be used to extract total protein or subcellular fractions or organelles from the various sample types. It works by disrupting the lipid membranes or the cell wall. Some of the components may need to be removed from the downstream analysis. High concentrations of the salts and detergents are not compatible with protein assays and mass spectroscopy. And if you look at the physical disruption method we have seen, and they may require some expensive equipments. Okay, it may be cumbersome to use. Reproducibility may be varying. Mechanical methods are generally not compatible with high throughput and small volumes. Protein denaturation or aggregation can occur if you are using this physical method, like heating or ultrasonication kind of thing. Okay, so the cells disrupt at different times, so subcellular components may be subjected to ongoing disruptive forces. Okay, so if you overall compare all these methods, we have mechanical method, we have liquid homogenization method, we have sonication method, we have freeze-thaw method, and even sometimes manual grinding also can be done. Okay, so if you look at the freeze-thaw lysis method, so we freeze the cell containing solution and we suddenly bring it above 0 degree Celsius and do that one. Okay, so there are mechanical methods, there are liquid methods, liquid shear methods, and we have this freeze-thaw method, we have grinding method, we have ultrasonication methods. So and the apparatus used are listed here. Okay, so these are some of the photographs of the how this osmotic shock occurs. So as I said, osmotic shocks, when the shell is shrinking and shriveling, so that ice present in it or the solid type nature present in it can help the cell wall to break. Okay, so these are some of the equipments which are used for this cell disruption. And this is also one thing, heartbreaker tissue is there, so micro mincer is similar to the what we have seen earlier.
So this micro mincer is a compact hand operated screw press type cell disruptor.
So it can be used to separate out the cells in organelles from these fresh plant and animal tissues like muscle, liver, brain, epicotyl and pulpy leaf tissues. There won't be any sample loss and no heat generation, no foaming or no aerosol problems. So much of the sample without added buffer is pushed through a 250 micron stainless steel sieve under thousands of pounds of force. So in the case of the plant tissues, fibrous cellulosic pulp is left behind while cell juice and intracellular products are extruded. So the resultant extract can be deposited directly into the microtubes. So this heartbreak tissue homogenizer is used. So it can be used in the cold room or placed in the refrigerator in order to keep samples at low temperature and eliminate the noise. Okay. So when you are doing it in cold storage, means low temperature, that heating effect can be nullified. There is no heating of the samples, and also this disruption technique is fast. Okay. So in conclusion, so we have seen several disruption techniques, and all these techniques are necessary part of any industrial production line. It offers so many benefits for the enhancement of the product recovery. As I said, there may be two objectives. One is to just isolate the parts or the organelles present in the cell. That is one option. Another option, as I said, is the purpose of doing cell disruption is one of the downstream processing step. First step, because as I said, these in the downstream processing, out of the fermenter we will get three type of product. Because what happens in the fermenter is we have a substrate, and substrate is the raw material. It's like similar to when you say A is the reactant, B is the product. We use some catalyst C, right? A giving C as the product, right? So whereas in case of a fermenter, what happens is we have a substrate which is getting converted into some product. Okay, then instead of catalyst we use some microorganisms. So what are all involved here? Substrate is involved, microorganism is involved, and product is formed. So obviously three things are coming out, means a minimum three is coming out of the fermentator reaction. So that's why downstream processing is very important. So we will have the substrate, because unreacted substrate will be there. It's not that 100% conversion of substrate takes place. So unreacted substrate will be coming out, and the cells will be coming out, microorganisms will be coming out. And if it is, as I said, there can be three type of products. So it can be cell, or it can be intracellular product, which means that whatever product is formed, which will be present inside the cell of the microorganism. Otherwise it can be extracellular product can be formed. So that extracellular means whatever product is formed, the cell wall from the cell it has come out. That means in the liquid, the desired product is present in the liquid outside the cell wall. Okay, so these three types are there. In all these three, we have to carry out the centrifugation step. And then we have to, if the product is present inside the cell, we have to make use of these cell disruption techniques. Okay. So because as a product, we have to recover the product, the properties of the recovered product also significant, because the method that you are using, as I said, can be denature the product which is formed. So we should that, but thermally stable compound, you can make use of thermal method, right? So like that, we have to consider the properties of the product that is formed, and also the economic condition, like which method is costlier, which is cheap. Because at the industry level, you have to think of the two things. There should be trade-off between what is the percentage recovery we need, what is the product quality, what are the economic factor, I mean, so what is the cost, all that we have to consider, right? So a trade-off should be done while choosing a appropriate cell disruption techniques. Okay, still people work on developing better cell disruption techniques, and we can also contribute if you are looking to understand the basics of all this, what is ultrasonication, what is this, how it works, what is RFIs, all that. So we try to design a better equipment which can be commercially available for the biotechnologists or biochemical engineers to make use of. Okay. So are there any questions? Those who have no questions can leave. If you have questions, we can ask, interact with me. No issues. I think we will stop here and continue in the next lecture.